Good morning, everybody. I'm glad you guys are able to join us today as we continue our series looking at some of the different things that we kind of believe, just some of the stuff that the church has believed and the faith of Christianity, and just kind of getting a better understanding of where we kind of get some of our ideas and just kind of digging into some of the deeper topics that often are not really dealt with a whole lot. And so today, we're going to be looking at a new topic. And the past couple of weeks, I'll admit, they've been a little dense. It's been dealing with a lot of more in-depth stuff than most people probably really care about. But it is very important as far as some foundational knowledge as to how we start to get some of these beliefs that we're going to kind of go through. So starting this week, we're going to be looking at more doctrinal beliefs. So we're going to deal more with how the church views different things. And predominantly, because this is a Christian church, we're going to kind of look at how the Christian church looks at things. And so depending on different books and different churches that you go to, they may have different views, different theological views and doctrinal beliefs than we would. And so today is the day that we really kind of kick all of that good stuff off, where we kind of deal with that doctrine and that theology. And hopefully this is going to be a lot more practical than the past couple of weeks have been. The past couple of weeks have just kind of been drinking out of a fire hose to kind of get a foundation of, you know, understanding some of these things. And so hopefully this is going to be a lot more practical, and you'll be able to walk out of here and you'll be like, hey, you know, now I actually am taking something away from the sermon for us. So hopefully that happens. Before I get things kicked off, a while back, so I don't know about you guys, I'm a big history person. I love history. I love to know about history. I'm not exactly the most political person, you know, but because of history and my fascination with history, I am always fascinated by, you know, past presidential candidates, you know, those who have become president, what their political beliefs were, those kinds of things, and just kind of where they stood in America. You know, how did people in America feel about them when they were in office? And I was looking up who the most well-received were, right? So they do polls, and they kind of gauge how presidential candidates are being received in the United States. And I wanted to know who were the most well-received presidents in history. One of the presidents with, I think, I'm almost positive he had the highest approval rating. I could be wrong, he might have been like top three, but I'm pretty sure he was number one, and of course it'll depend on which polls you look at. Number one, most of you may have heard this name before. It was a guy by the name of John F. Kennedy. So that name, I don't know, maybe some of you, you're like, I hated that dude. Maybe some of you are like, who was that dude, because you weren't born yet, like I was. Let's just be honest. I don't know who John F. Kennedy hardly was. I know he was riding around in Dallas. I know that was the last time he was in Dallas. Like, I don't know a whole lot about what was going on with John F. Kennedy. My mom kind of remembers a little bit of JFK. But one of the things that always sticks out the most about JFK is his inaugural speech. Like, when I think of JFK, one of the things that instantly comes to mind, like, it's in video games, it's in movies, it's in all kinds of stuff. One of the things that sticks out about JFK was his inaugural address, predominantly the part where he says, "Ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country." That is like his big statement. And what I find so funny about that is that, like, in a democracy, which, you know, in a republic, in a democracy, you know, like what the United States is, that's like not the point of our method of government. That's like not the point. The point of a republic and of a democracy is that the people kind of have say on what is going on in the country, right? So we elect people, we vote people in, and they are, you know, supposed to do what we kind of expect them to do. That's why we put our voice and that's why we put our vote behind these people. One thing that I do find interesting is that that whole speech about, you know, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country, that actually applies a lot more to the church. That applies a lot more to the church, this body of believers that is the church. And today we're going to be looking at the study of the church, so the doctrine of the church. And the big word for the day, we can go ahead and put that next slide up. The big word for the day, if you are one of the note takers, you want to learn all the dirty words and all the terminology, is this word, ecclesiology. Ecclesiology. Essentially, it's the study of the church. That's kind of one generic definition for what that word means, but it ultimately kind of entails several different things. It entails how the church was formed, what makes up the church, what should the church believe, what are the core doctrines, what are the practices that the church should be following, who is to lead the church, what should their qualifications be. There's a lot of stuff that goes into looking at the church. And so today, we're going to kind of step into this study of ecclesiology, this study of the church. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Acts chapter 2. Now, a while back when I first got here, Brandon Bradley had been going through the book of Acts. And I kind of filled in and ended up more or less finishing it. I don't know if we really finished it because it was like, man, we've been in this bad boy for like 40 weeks. So we kind of wrapped up. But we were looking at the book of Acts, and Acts is kind of the Christian church go-to for what do we believe about the church. That is like, that's kind of the cornerstone for the Christian church's ideas of the church, and that's where we're going to kind of look for this initial study. Now, if you're with me and you're following along, it says this. We're going to look predominantly at verse 42. So we're going to start in verse 42. So Acts chapter 2, verse 42, it says this. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs were being performed through the apostles. Now all the believers were together and held all things in common. They sold their possessions and property and distributed the proceeds to all as any had need. Every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple and broke bread from house to house. They ate their food with joyful and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. Every day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. So here we kind of get our first point from this passage. If we could go ahead and put that up. The first point of this sermon is this, that the early church was all about the community of believers. The early church was all about the community of believers. It wasn't about some of these things that we kind of see today. There's the way that church is done in America is very interesting and not very in line with how it was done in the book of Acts. There's a lot of divisions that are kind of taking place. People, they argue and they bicker about different things, you know, what color the carpet is, you know, chairs versus pews. For the record, I've never been good at dancing, so if I step on toes, sorry. But, you know, they find all these different things, and churches have broken apart and separated from each other over very small things. And for the most part, we really only see that in America. Because in America, we kind of have this mindset of, you know, being with like-minded folks, right? So being with like-minded people. And so oftentimes there's issues that arise when we are around people who do not have the same mindsets as us, and it kind of causes division. So I've seen my fair share of church splits within the church. And it's kind of been a crazy phenomenon that I've seen, but that's not the way church was. The early church was all about community, about them coming together rather than them being divided, rather than the different denominations existing. So rather than there being Baptists, Lutherans, Catholics, Christian Church, Methodists, Church of Christ, Disciples of Christ, rather than there being all of these different denominations, the church came together as one community in order to worship God together, because really, essentially, in an empire that was kind of looking to, you know, kill them and persecute them, they were the only ones that they had. There were much bigger fish to fry than, you know, how often do we take communion and how often do we, you know, do these things and what about this and what about that. There were bigger fish to fry. It was like, hey, let's try to survive, let's meet up, and let's break bread together and have fellowship with one another. The early church was all about community. Now, my caveat is this. As many of you know, many of you have probably grown up here. If you haven't, you've grown up somewhere. Like, you're here today, you grew up somewhere. And odds are you were probably there for a while. Community is not always perfect. Community is not always perfect. Because we are broken people. We make mistakes. We drop the ball on certain things. We argue. We have issues. Instantly, I kind of think of family. You know, family is like, even though we're family and we love each other, like, there are still issues that arise amongst family members. And the church ought to be this kind of community, but that doesn't mean that problems just go away. What it does mean is that oftentimes we have to set aside those differences, those issues, those problems for the betterment of each other. That's what they did in the church that we find in Acts. That when they have issues, when problems arise, they gather around and they support each other through those problems. The second verse that I want us to look at, the second passage, is 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it brings up a different view of the church, and it's this. If we can go ahead and put that up, we're going to be in verse 12. We got a long way to go. Trek along. I promise I'm reading straight through this, and we're not breaking it down a whole lot. It says this: for just as the body is one and has many parts, and all the parts of that body, though many, are one body, so also is Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we were all given one Spirit to drink. Indeed, the body is not one part, but many. If the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I don't belong to the body, it is not for that reason any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I don't belong to the body, it is not for that reason any less part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God has arranged each one of the parts in the body just as he wanted. And if they were all the same part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. Or again, the head can't say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that are weaker are indispensable. And those parts of the body that we consider less honorable, we clothe these with greater honor, and our unrespectable parts are treated with greater respect, which our respectable parts do not need. Instead, God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the less honorable, so that there would be no division in the body, but that the members would have the same concern for each other. So if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. If one member is honored, all the members rejoice with him. Now you are the body of Christ and individual members of it. And God has appointed these in the church: first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, next miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, leading, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all do miracles? Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But desire the greater gifts. And I'll show you an even better way. There's a lot that can be broken down, and that can all be done at a later point. We can look at that some other time. The point that I want to bring from this passage is this. If we can go ahead and put that up. The church is not a building, but a body. The church is not a building, but a body. It is not a building that people go to and you go to church. That is just a word that we gave to the building that holds the church. The church is us. We are the body of Christ. We are the bride of Christ. We make up the church, not the building. And the reason for that, we're going to kind of deal with here in a second. But that has a much more practical approach to how we look at the church. If we recognize that the church is not a building, it is us, we're going to be able to kind of start to understand that the church is not about programs. The church is not about what it has to offer, because we are the church. If we are the church, it's not about where we go to get things from the church. The church is not some product that is bought. We are the church. If we can go ahead and put the next verse into this. I'm not going to dwell too much in these next upcoming verses. It essentially just drives home a different point. And it's this. Ephesians chapter 5, 22 through 24, it says, "Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord, because the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the Savior of the body. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives are to submit to their husbands in everything." We're not going to deal with that part. We'll deal with that some other time, like when I marry and have a time to actually say something about that. I get it. I understand. You know, like, I could stand up here and talk about marriage all day long, and as a single dude, you're like, you have no idea what you're talking about.
Exactly.
So we're not going to do that. We'll save that for some other time, maybe 10 years in the future, when I have some things to complain about and we can talk about. When I'm more experienced in that realm, we can deal with that then. The point that I'm trying to make from this particular passage is that the church is the bride of Christ. And in Revelation chapter 19, verse 7, it says this: "Let us be glad, rejoice, and give him glory, because the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has prepared herself." That passage is talking about the union of the church and Christ, that the Lamb has come, and a marriage is to be formed, and we are the bride of Christ. If we can go ahead and put that slide up, that point. The church is the bride of Christ. And as Ephesians laid out for us, we are called to serve and be submissive to Christ. That is the ministry and the mission and the goal of the church, is ultimately to achieve the will of Jesus on earth. The goal of the church is to achieve the will of God on earth. That is why we exist. It is to serve Christ. And so, if And I'm going to kind of unpack this next point, is this. Tying back in with the wise words with JFK. Ask not what the church can do for you, but what you can do for the church. As I mentioned earlier, about kind of this idea of us having community with one another and us being the church, not a building. And now we're talking about how we can serve the church. We can serve the body of believers rather than what a church can do for you. It brings me to this. This is something I wasn't really sure how I was going to get into, but it's kind of something that's just been relatively heavy on my heart. I'm a huge fan of America. I want to throw that out there, get that out of the way. I am very blessed to live in this country. I believe that the way that this country handles kind of commercialism has been very detrimental to how we perceive the church. This is what I mean by that. Oftentimes in America, we have a lot of blessings. We have a decent economy for the most part, and as such, we're able to kind of, you know, buy tools, buy products, buy phones, buy laptops, whatever it is. And essentially, we're kind of looking for a product that is going to do what we want it to. And oftentimes, that thought doesn't leave our minds when we step into the foot of church. Or not the foot of church. When we step into a church building. Oftentimes, that thought kind of sticks with us. I've been guilty of it, and I know plenty of people who have. Right, and so essentially, the thought process is this. I tithe. I give money to this church. This church should do what I want. I should have a say in what this church does. I should make sure that the programs of this church are essentially what I actually want. And we have kind of turned the church into this product that is to be sold rather than a community that we are to be a part of. No church is perfect. No church is perfect. If you wanted to look for a church that's perfect, you would be hopping from church to church week after week after week, because everywhere you go, something is going to kind of rub you the wrong way, and it's just not going to line up with how you might see things, how you might view things, or some of the things that you want. And it's very important that we have a proper understanding of the church. That the church is not a building with programs and things to offer. Well, there's nothing inherently wrong with programs. I'm not opposed to Bible studies and, you know, church services and, you know, having a full-fledged band and things like that, and being able to get kind of connected and plugged into the community. I'm not opposed to those things. My issue stems when people start to go to these things and they're like, well, the donuts aren't that good. Like, this church has better coffee. You know, this church has better donuts. This church, they do lunch every Sunday, not just once a month. And some of you might laugh, you might think in your head, like, well, that's dumb, nobody does that. I promise you, people do. And I promise you, I've been one of them. When I was in college, I wish I could say it stopped in high school, but honestly, it didn't even start until I went to college. In high school and middle school, I was all about my church. The church that I grew up in down in Houston, if they were serving, I was there. If the youth was doing a service project, I was there. If they had a Bible study, I was there. I was involved and invested in a church. But as soon as I left high school and had to start finding my own church in college, my ideas of what to look for didn't really line up. And I remember I went to this thing that the school hosted, the college hosted, and it was a way to get plugged into these different churches. And I remember, you know, because we're kind of talking about more of a corporatized church, I remember the sales pitches that I was getting from these churches that wanted me to come and be a part of their community. Essentially, it was like, hey, we know you're a broke college student. That was true. I was poor. I didn't have money when I was in college. We feed lunch to our college students every single Sunday. And I was like, well, hey, Sunday's the one meal that the school doesn't provide. So now that's one less meal that I have to pay for. I think I'll go there. And I went there, and there was some time I was serving. I got kind of plugged in, and I was like, man, I just don't really know. I just don't know if this is really the church for me. And I started looking, and I was like, well, what about this church? You know, they have a full-fledged band. They got a light show. And I'm like, that's really cool. They hadn't quite upgraded to the fog machine yet. That hadn't been incorporated yet. You know, like, they put the essential oils in the fog machine so that when it blows out, it's like, oh, it smells nice. It smells like a concert in here. It was one of those churches, not yet. But I was like, they got a light show. Hey, they also do meals for their students. Hey, they have Bible studies for their college students. I'm going to start going there. And it became less about how I can get plugged in and serve in the community and more about how can this community serve me. And that's not the way that we should be looking. Now, here's what I'm not saying. I'm not saying be like ride or die for your church, and that if somebody gets up on stage and they're like preaching straight up heresy, you're like, yeah, I'm sticking here. If your church is heretical, don't go there. You know, maybe don't be there. But that's what we need to start really focusing on when we talk about where we choose to have our community and where we choose to serve. Does their doctrine line up with what the Bible says? When they lead worship, are the songs that they're singing meant to just be more emotional and draw an emotion out of me rather than actually be a way for me to worship? Is it all about how I feel? Or is it more so about what they teach? I think it's incredibly important to find ways to get plugged into a church. I think ultimately you will never be happy at a church until you find a way to get plugged in and truly be a part of the community. So ask not what the church can do for you, but what you can do for the church. Today the announcements, Clay mentioned a meal that we're going to be doing in November. In November we're going to kind of have a meal. If I'm not mistaken, it'll be happening after church. Is that correct? Yeah, so it'll be the after church meal. We're going to do that November 20th. Okay. I don't have the notes right out in front of me, so. A while back, we did a meal similar to what we're going to be doing in November. We had a meal, and we kind of discussed ways that we want to see this church, this body of believers, reach out into the community of Bell and the surrounding communities, but also how we can better serve the community here in this next meal that we have in November. We're going to be kind of talking about the same things. We're going to be dealing with some of those topics that were brought up and some of those ways that we want to serve the community and serve this church here. And I invite you guys to come to that. And it's roughly a month away. It's a little, today's not, it's a little over a month, or a little less than a month. It's a little less than a month. From now until that meal, my prayer for you is this, that as we get ready and as we have roughly less than a month to kind of prepare and get ready for this meal, I want you to really think, how can I be involved? What can I do? How can I offer my service to benefit this community? I hope it doesn't turn into a sales pitch of, you know, what does this church now have to offer me, you know, if I decide to go there, if I decide to place my membership. I hope that it becomes an opportunity for us to really think about how we, as a church, as a body of believers, will actively serve the community. So that's just kind of my prayer, my challenge for you guys is, as we approach that, be thinking about ways that we can serve. There's going to be ideas that are thrown out. I know one of the ideas that has been kind of thrown out is hosting Bible studies. Just hosting a Bible study, maybe for a while it meets here, and it would be throughout the week, so not to take away from what Garrett does on Sunday nights, but Bible studies that meet. Not everybody can meet on Sunday. Not everybody can make it on a Sunday night. Maybe some of you have days that would be available elsewhere. So I would just like to encourage you to think about ways that you can really start to invest in the community. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the state you've given us. God, I thank you for your church. I thank you for your Son who came and died on a cross for our sins so that your church could be established. God, I thank you for the examples that we get from the book of Acts. God, I thank you for the teaching of your church and what it looks like to be a Christian, what it looks like to take part in this community of believers. God, I pray that as we leave here that we would be looking to find ways that we can serve you. God, we know that ultimately you are the head of this body. God, I pray that you would use us to further your kingdom and further your will. God, I pray that you would just give us the wisdom to do so. God, I pray that we would really analyze our hearts and find out how we can serve and also importantly what we value in the community. God, we thank you. We love you for all that you do. And it's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen. One quick plug that I wanted to kind of put out there because I forgot to do it earlier, so that's my bad. If you are following along in the notes on your phone, if you're following along in the app, you probably saw a couple of resources, a couple of links that have been added. Oh, wow. Garrett, you're the man. You are awesome. Garrett did that. That was not me. So the links are to these two books. One book is The Portable Seminary. I have a copy of it here. This bad boy is thick and full of all kinds of information. For me, these are resources that I use as a tool. This is not like a, you know what, I'm going to brew some coffee and I'm going to sit down and just plow through this bad boy. This is not that kind of a book for me. This is something where when I have questions, when I have things that I'm wondering about, when I want to know what does the Bible teach about these things, these are those kinds of books. So if you are looking for those kinds of resources, if that is something that you are interested in, I would encourage checking these out. The Portable Seminary, that's the one that I just held up. That has all different kinds of contributors. So there are people from all different kind of theological views, and those deal with church history, the first 500 years of the church, what did it look like in Acts, what did it look like in medieval times, what did it look like in 1950, and it deals with some of that stuff. It also deals with some of the doctrine and theology that we're going to be dealing with. But just be aware that there are different people with different views that will be kind of explaining some of those different topics. The one on the right, I had to double check. I was like, it's on the right for me, but I don't know about you. So the one on the right, that is a book that was written by one of my former professors at Lincoln Christian University. His name is Dr. Cohn. Lincoln Christian University is part of the Christian Church movement. And so, for the most part, I didn't read it like word for word. It wasn't that kind of a book. But I did use it as one of the textbooks. That book is going to deal with some of the beliefs that we have as a Christian. And so those are just a couple of resources I wanted to plug for you guys in case you're interested in that sort of thing. That is all. We're moving into the time of invitations, so if you have any prayer requests that you would like to have lifted up, if you have any decisions that you would like to make, anything at all, now will be the time to